Namaskar, good evening. You are watching Rajya Sabha Television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with News Tonight. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. Use your vote to fulfill dreams of the country, says Prime Minister Narendra Modi in an appeal to voters. Asserts that not voting causes great anguish. Prime Minister urges top politicians and personalities to encourage people to cast their ballots in record numbers in the upcoming Lok Sabha elections. Government files affidavit in Supreme Court on the leak of Rafael case documents, calls act of photocopying sensitive papers regarding the compatibilities of the aircraft a conspiracy that affects national security. JDS and Congress seal seat sharing deal in Karnataka. Congress to contest 20 seats in the state, JDS settles for 8 seats after initially demanding 12. Prime Minister Narendra Modi's 5-year tenure has been a turning point on corruption, says Arun Jaitley. In the third part of his blog, Agenda 2019, the finance minister asserts that the Modi government and its ministers have shown how to run an honest government, underscores not a single charge of any substance has been made against him. And BJP delegation meets election commission officials, demands that West Bengal be declared a highly vulnerable state. Seek the deployment of central forces in every polling booth. Party lodges complaint against Congress President Rahul Gandhi's remarks against Prime Minister. First up, all the news from the upcoming Lok Sabha elections 2019. Prime Minister Narendra Modi has urged people to cast their votes in the upcoming Lok Sabha polls in a series of tweets. Prime Minister tagged politicians and celebrities from Bollywood and sports, urging them to help bring more people out to vote in April-May national elections. The Prime Minister tagged his political opponents, including Rahul Gandhi, Mamata Banerjee, Sharad Pawar, Mayawati, Akhilesh Yadav, Tejaswi Yadav and M.K. Stalin, and appealed to them to encourage increased voter participation in the elections. In a tweet, he said that a high turnout augurs well for our democratic fabric. In another tweet, he tagged Telangana Chief Minister K. Chandrasekhar Rao, Odisha Chief Minister Naveen Patnaik, Karnataka Chief Minister H. D. Kumaraswamy and YSR Congress leader Jagan Mohan Reddy, urging them to work towards bringing maximum Indians to the polling booths in the upcoming elections. Voter awareness efforts be strengthened across the length and breadth of India, he said. He sent out tweets to young and veteran Bollywood stars using widely popular catchphrases from their blockbuster movies and asked them to motivate their fans to vote. Stars from regional cinema including Mohanlal and Nagarjun were also tagged by Prime Minister Narendra Modi, apart from several media personnel and politicians. Union Minister Arun Jaitley on Wednesday said that Prime Minister Narendra Modi's 5-year tenure will be regarded by future political historians as a turning point where a movement to free India of corruption began. In a blog titled, "Is Prime Minister Narendra Modi's first 5-year tenure a turning point on corruption?" he wrote that the government and its ministers have conclusively proved that it is possible to run an honest government in India. Attacking the Congress, the finance minister said that India's credibility on issues of corruption touched rock bottom before 2014. He wrote, "Under Modi government, A new normal has now been established in India. If you don't pay back the banks, you will be out of management. If you escape out of the country, you will be extradited back. Prior to May 2014, corridors of North Block and Udyog Bhavan used to be flooded with businessmen and industrialists, but today they are vacant, he wrote. Because in Modi government, files are not pushed but decided on merit and in national interest. Once at the helm, these middlemen have been rendered jobless. He further said, for the first time, we have had a government for 5 years which has not increased any taxes. On the contrary, it has reduced many and yet significantly increased the tax base and the tax collection. This has enabled greater spending for defence, poverty alleviation and infrastructure. And for a wider analysis on this, we'll go across to Mr. Sanjay Singh, political editor, First Post. Sir, thank you so much for speaking to Rajya Sabha Television. Ahead of the upcoming Lok Sabha elections, what are we given to understand from Arun Jaitley's blog on BJP's governance?
See, Arun Jaitley is very consistent on the issues on which he is writing. A chaos versus clarity in terms of Modi versus entire opposition and various other things. Any issue which government thinks is critical, Jaitley is very articulately voicing his opinion. And today's his blog, I would agree with Jaitley on several counts. The point that he says that corridors of power in New Delhi, North Block, South Block, Krishi Bhavan, Udyog Bhavan, Nirman Bhavan and other houses where ministries of Union Government house, those corridors of power have been freed from middlemen, and you don't actually see presence of people who otherwise you don't recognize, but they used to have kind of a swag and you would ask somebody as to who this gentleman is, because their confidence was such they would walk with poise and move very freely. And therefore, that particular thing is very clear. Also, this government has made very smart use and with certain degree of commitment to eliminate middleman in terms of be it manrega payment, be it other benefits, cash benefit transfer, be it fertilizer, be it any other gas subsidy and so on and so forth, scholarship, pensions, Vidyavastha, and that list would go on. So when he says that historians of future generation will actually decide that this was a turning point, this is slightly early to say that, but in times to come, yes, this government, if you compare this government with governments of past, in fact, this is one election whereby the opposition does not have any credible argument on corruption. Of course, Rahul Gandhi is trying to whip up a passion, trying to whip up an argument over Rafale deal.
Right.
Something where CAG and Supreme Court has given clean chit to the government.
Right. And how successful has the Modi government been in providing an actionable template for the future dispensations on fighting with corruption?
See, Modi government has laid a very strong foundation on this count. With help of technology, they have eliminated, in fact, the one thing which Piyush Goyal then, since Arun Jaitley was out of country because of his illness. And while presenting that, but one nagging point some people who filed tax returns had was there was several queries from Income Tax Department and they had to go to the assessing officer, and there was scope of harassment as well as corruption. That particular part has also been eliminated. And remember when Jaitley says that Rajiv Gandhi once had said, and Modi also uses that particular thing, that out of 1 rupee which is sent from the center, only 15 paisa reaches on the ground, rest 85 paisa is taken by layers and layers of middlemen. That particular part this government has eliminated. That I think is a very, very credible achievement. On various counts, they have been successful on this particular count. And therefore, Modi, apart from what Jaitley has said, Jaitley's blog, of course, would reach to people he intends to. But fact remains, Modi as campaigner, Modi as leader, Modi as prime minister, He has been talking about this particular thing in his public rallies, where he says that why all these parties are up against him. As a chowkidar, he was alert, and these parties were actually actually finding it difficult. And because he would narrate as to how the corruption was, the cycle of corruption used to go on, and therefore they are building a narrative to go into election with what Jaitley has said today as a counterpoint, as a talking point. This of course would also reach to his party workers, and they would take this thing to the masses.
How far has the government been able to fulfill its promise to the electors on the issue of corruption?
See, since the time Modi government came to power, I think one of the biggest challenge, and remember, in 2014 he came to power, the country was, morale was low, and all 2G scam, Commonwealth scam, you had coal scam, and all these scams were figuring in public debate, and there was a feeling that nothing could be done, kuch nahi ho sakta hai, corruption in high places as well as corruption at lower level, where it was nagging, say for instance, be it driving license, be your ration card, be your pension, be your scholarship, be it so many other things also. Corruption in high places was a corruption of different genre at a far higher level, and therefore public discourse was also centered around that, and corruption at lower level was actually troubling your day-to-day life. And therefore, when this government came, this was a stiff challenge for them. And from days as days passed by, in fact, it was clear that they were taking some very strong action on this part. The only regret people perhaps would have on this particular count is that the people who were actually behind the 2G scam, or say coal scam or Commonwealth scam, are not actually behind bar, or some of
right.
them are behind bars. There are also an argument that some bureaucrats whose connivance was not so much there, but just because their notings were on the file, actually gone to jail.
Right.
And therefore, people would have liked to see that those who were actually instrumental in these scams were booked and sent behind the bars.
Right. Thank you so much, Mr. Singh, for joining us and helping us understand this important topic in detail. Moving on, the BJP on Wednesday urged the Election Commission to declare West Bengal as a super sensitive state to ensure fair Lok Sabha polls there, and demanded that central forces be deployed at all polling stations in the state. A BJP delegation, including Union Ministers Ravi Shankar Prasad, Nirmala Sitharaman, JP Nadda, and party's General Secretaries Bhupendra Yadav and Kailash Vijayvargiya, met the top officials of the poll body and apprised them of their demands. The party has also requested the poll panel to transfer those police officers whose electoral impartiality is questionable, as well as the withdrawal of former Kolkata Police Commissioner Rajiv Kumar from the election duty. The delegation brought to the Election Commission's notice incidents wherein the state bureaucracy has become completely subservient to the TMC, negating the very doctrine of impartiality and fairness. The state assumes importance for the Saffron Party. The BJP delegation also alleged that Congress Chief Rahul Gandhi broke the model code of conduct by levelling unverified allegations against the Prime Minister yesterday in Ahmedabad, and complained to the poll panel regarding the same. And West Bengal Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee slammed the BJP for urging the Election Commission to treat all booths in the state as super sensitive. She alleged the BJP was trying to hide behind the central forces as it can't win any seat in the state.
What is the cause to declare all the booths sensitive? Don't you think it's a humiliation, insultation? Why BJP people are very sensitive about Bengal? Why they are so scared? Why they are so afraid? Bengal, what senior leaders they said? Absolutely lie, if I say blatant lie.
Mamata Banerjee also announced names of all 42 Trinamool Congress candidates in the state for the upcoming Lok Sabha elections. 41% of the party's candidates are women, which includes Munmun Sen, Nusrat Jahan, Mimi Chakraborty and Mahua Moitra. And Union Minister Smriti Irani launched a scathing attack on the Congress leadership. Addressing a press conference, Irani questioned the land deals involving Rahul Gandhi and Priyanka Gandhi Vadra, citing a media report and some documents on land deals allegedly in favor of the Congress president and his sister. Smriti Irani alleged that the Congress has come to define family corruption. The opposition party termed the charges baseless and asked why had the BJP not probed the deal in the last 5 years if they were wrongdoing. Congress President Rahul Gandhi launched the UPA's poll campaign in Tamil Nadu on Wednesday. Addressing a public rally in Kanyakumari, Rahul Gandhi launched an attack on the AIADMK-BJP alliance in the state. He alleged that the AIADMK government in Tamil Nadu was controlled from Delhi. Earlier, during an interaction with a student of Stella Maris College, the Congress chief was questioned about Robert Vadra. In reply, he said that the government has every right to investigate every person, but law must apply to everybody.
Facing our country is acute joblessness and unemployment. Thousands and thousands and thousands of Indian youngsters, millions of Indian youngsters are looking for jobs and have nothing to do. The Prime Minister gave India demonetization and a flawed GST.
The government on Wednesday initiated the process of notifying the dates of the 7-phase Lok Sabha polls to President Ram Nath Kovind. Election Commission's recommendations will be sent to the President, who will then approve the issuance of notifications for the different phases of elections. The first notification will be issued on 18th of March for the polls beginning from April 11th. The Election Commission had announced the poll schedule on 10th of March and sent the recommendations to the Union Law Ministry to notify about the upcoming Lok Sabha election dates. Based on the recommendations, the Law Ministry prepares a proposal for the Union Cabinet, which recommends to the President for further approval. The issuing of the notifications would begin the election process for constituting the 17th House of the People. The Congress and the JDS have reached a seat-sharing agreement in Karnataka for the upcoming Lok Sabha polls. As per the agreement, the Congress party will contest on 20 seats out of 28 Lok Sabha seats. JDS will contest on 8 seats. As per the media reports, JDS will contest from Uttar Kannada, Chikamangaluru, Shimoga, Tumkur, Hassan, Mandya, Bengaluru North and Vijayapura constituencies. The JDS had initially demanded 12 seats from the Congress, but they settled on 8 after H.D. Kumaraswamy's meeting with Rahul Gandhi. And with that, we'll slip into a very quick break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us. Welcome back. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu has said that the education system in the country should be reoriented by ensuring greater linkage between academia and industry to make students employable. addressing students at the Well Tech University in Chennai on Wednesday. The vice president said that business incubation has been globally recognized as an important tool for economic development and job creation. He added that innovation, incubation and startups are the buzzwords in today's world, and countries and societies which are knowledge-centric and technology-driven will play an increasing role in the global economy.
In the coming 10 years, India will become the third largest economy in the world. That is the forecast. So with innovation, with incubation, with knowledge excelling, we will fast forward the progress of the country. Today, the country has opportunity to focus on innovation in the field of education, to meet the global competition. But this requires tremendous transformation from reorienting the curriculum framework to refining the infrastructure with the sole objective of imparting world-class quality education.
Some more developments. The centre told the Supreme Court on Wednesday that documents filed by the petitioners seeking review of its Rafale deal verdict are sensitive to national security. In an affidavit, the centre said that those who conspired in photocopying the papers have committed theft and put national security in jeopardy by leaking them. The centre said those who have conspired in this leakage are guilty of offences under the IPC, including theft by unauthorised photocopying and leakage of sensitive official documents affecting national security. The Ministry of Defence said an internal inquiry commenced on February 28th and is in progress over the leakage of sensitive documents, and it is of utmost concern to find out where the leakage took place. The review pleas were filed against the December 14th verdict of the Apex Court, dismissing all the pleas against the deals procured by India from France. The Supreme Court on Wednesday questioned the centre and the Assam government over the functioning of the foreigner tribunals. Assam is facing threat of external aggression because of the large scale of influx of immigrants. A bench of Chief Justice Ranjan Gogoi and Justices Deepak Gupta and Sanjeev Khanna questioned the centre and the Assam government over the steps being taken to resolve this threat. The foreigners' tribunals have identified 56,697 persons as foreigners, and thus far and yet only around 900 persons are in the detention centres. Next hearing is on 27th of March. The court had expressed concern over the thousands of illegal migrants being kept in detention centres for years in Assam without being repatriated or deported to their countries of origin. And clarifying last year's order on police reforms, the Supreme Court said on Wednesday that only officers who have a minimum of 6 months tenure left in service should be considered for the post of Director General of Police. A bench headed by Chief Justice Ranjan Gogoi said the recommendations for the post of DGP by the UPSC and preparation of the panel should be purely on the basis of the merit. The court had in July last year passed a slew of directions on police reforms and restrained all the states and union territories from appointing any police officer as acting DGPs to avoid favouritism and nepotism in such high-level appointments. All Boeing 737 MAX 8 aircraft being operated by the Indian Airlines have been grounded in the wake of Ethiopian Airlines crash. Directorate General of Civil Aviation has decided to ground all Boeing 737 MAX 8 with immediate effect to ensure safety of the passengers. The Civil Aviation Ministry held a meeting with the representatives of all airlines to discuss ways to avoid causing trouble to the passengers. SpiceJet has 12 such aircrafts in its fleet, and Jet Airways has 5, which have already been grounded. On Wednesday, 14 flights of SpiceJets were cancelled after the decision. Civil Aviation Secretary P.S. Kharola said that the operators have also agreed not to indulge in predatory pricing.
We had this meeting, and in this meeting, the basic purpose was to ensure that the safety instructions of DGCA should be followed by the concerned airlines which own these aircraft. And secondly, also to ensure that because of pulling out of about 12 aircraft of this make, passengers should not be inconvenienced. So we had a discussion with the airlines as to how they would plan to overcome the situation. Which flies to, which connects any place. It's a single flight, it should not be cancelled, so that connectivity to any place is not affected, and cancellation of flights should normally take place on those sectors which have multiple flights.
The European Union too closed its airspace to Boeing 737 MAX planes. Singapore, Australia, Malaysia, Argentina and Oman are among other countries to ban all MAX planes from their airspace. China and Indonesia have already ordered domestic airlines to suspend operations of the plane. Argentina's flag carrier also grounded 5 aircrafts on Tuesday, as did the airlines in countries including Brazil and Mexico. The US Federal Aviation Authority has also grounded the aircraft but ordered the manufacturer to make design changes. And that's all we have for you in this edition of News Tonight. Thank you for watching. Namaskar.